Good evening. Thanks for joining us for the Thinkers Dialogue today. And we have an extremely special guest today. His name is Srinath Srinivas. And in fact, he's very special for multiple reasons. In fact, one that he's my son's teacher and his music teacher. So my son learned his initial music from Srinath and they have been working together, or he's trying to learn from him. And in fact, I always hear stories that he wants to spend time with him in Goa and probably travel around with him. And that's where it is. So if you really look at this whole relationship, this is fairly exciting. So I'm just talking to a teacher who is an amazing person. In fact, when I say he's an amazing person, for a very interesting set of things that he has done. He's a drummer, he's an author, he's an educator, he teaches music, and he has done some crazy things in his life. And when I say crazy things in life is that he has cycled across Thailand, Nepal, Bhutan, and India. And he's biked for I do not know how many thousands of kilometers, but that's what he has actually done. Of course, on his first flight, he got the shudders because of the bumpy ride that he and thinking that he's dying. But those are separate anecdotal things that we will talk about as we go along. But he's an engineer by profession. And then he actually worked at, he was at Auroville in Puducherry for a few years. And that's when he got inspired to really do this biking or bicycle trip across the world. And then he actually wrote a book called Pedals and Perspectives. In fact, if you're able to see that, I would recommend that each one of us should read this for a simple reason that it's an amazing thing that he's writing, but I think it's the beauty of his writing, which is very simple. But I think there are some philosophical statements which are just fairly profound and deep. And I get surprised that it is coming from a fairly young man and with such deep thinking at this age. So it is just very powerful as a thing. And I hope he continues his writing over a period of time. And then, of course, he makes his own music. He actually does poetry. He manages he's on Instagram, and I've not followed him there, but then he, of course, runs his website called srinathsrinivasan.com. So that's where Srinath is. So Srinath, thanks a lot for joining us today. It is just a pleasure to have you with us.
Thanks so much, Amit, for that wonderful introduction. And I look forward to this chat.
You've done this crazy thing of 8 months of biking journey. What instilled or what was the spirit behind this biking journey? Now, for a person like me who's been thinking about doing it for many, many years, has just not done it. I just bike in the morning. But at the end of the day, what instilled that spirit in you?
Okay. So before this journey began, I was volunteering at a reforestation project in Auroville. And this is a place that's very dynamic in nature. Usually travelers who are traveling through India, they stop at this community where they stay for a couple of weeks and volunteer. Just to do their bit as they travel, so to say. And I stayed at this community for 2 years, and I saw people from all over the world just volunteering at this place and learning so much as they traveled. We see travel as some form of recreation, but here I was in the middle of this island which was serving as a hotbed of education for people who were seeking as they traveled. And I thought I should give myself the opportunity to learn as well. And for that, I must travel. So when I went to volunteer at that community, since it's a volunteering job, I'm not really earning that much to save enough to travel as my friend from other parts of the world. But I thought, okay, I'll try to find a way to travel within the limited means that I have, because I want to learn. So the spirit of learning was what drove me to my bicycle trip eventually. And then I thought, okay, I can't spend money on flight. So let's get creative with it. Let's travel on a bicycle. But even when this thought occurred to me, I did not have a bicycle with me. And if you go by popular advice on the internet, you really need a fancy bike to really, you know, you need nice pannier bags, this and that to travel. And I did not have that. But I was living in a community. And I always believed that if you share what you really want to do with the community comes together to help. So one fine day I announced in my community that I wish to travel in this manner. Now, how do I make this happen? And within 24 hours of that, someone gave me a second-hand bicycle. They said, you fix this and it's yours and the road is open for you. Someone got a few pannier bags, you know, some some traveler far back had left this. You're welcome to take this. Bucketfuls of advice came with me. I did not have to buy a single thing, and everything was in place for me the next day. So it was kind of fate telling me, you know, this is something you must do. You don't have any excuses to not do it. So this was born out of the deep need to learn on the open road as I traveled, but kind of the constraint I had with terms of the money kind of played into me choosing bicycle as a form of traveling. And I'm glad that that was the way it was, because when you travel on a bicycle, you go on such an easy, busy pace that you can actually observe things. If you find something of beauty, you can stop. You know, in the hinterland, that maybe does not feature on Google Maps. So it's a constraint in a way that, you know, you have to really put in physical effort to move forward. But the rewards you get from the people you meet and the places you go to, that's just something that's worth every ounce of energy put in pedaling. But to answer your question, yes, it was the spirit of learning that led me on this journey. And I'm really happy that that was the motivation, and this motivation was duly fulfilled by this long journey across South Asia on a second-hand bicycle.
So just for people to know, like, what was this crazy route that you took from starting from Auroville, Chennai, then Thailand, and you did some crazy travel. Like, so what was this route like? Just for people to understand the magnitude of travel that you have done on a bicycle, and how many kilometers?
So this is a question that comes in often. And to tell you the truth, I never counted it because it didn't matter. And I'll tell you why. So to speak about the route at first. So I started in Auroville. It's near Pondicherry. And one of my friends at the community who had done significant bicycle touring, he told me, you should start outside India and bicycle towards India so that you have a strong motivation to arrive somewhere, however long that takes. So I said, okay, let's do this. But which is the closest country that I can go to without me having to have bucket loads of money in my bank to ensure that I won't be staying back. You know, Indians have that issue if we apply for visas. And then I found out, okay, Thailand is a country that is relatively willing and we have good relations with them. I said, okay, let's go to Thailand. So I bicycled from Auroville till Chennai. That took 2 days. I took a flight to Bangkok So look how fate plays in, that the bicycle that was given to me by my community was a foldable bicycle. So I could fold it and take it in cargo and fly with it. So I flew across the Andaman Sea, landed in Bangkok. And when I land in Bangkok, it's a fresh slate. You look around, you can't read a single signboard. Everything is in Thai. But the willingness to go somewhere is there. And your will becomes the compass. Which direction do I want to go? I said, let's go north. That's the only decision I needed to take. And everything else followed. So I went from Thailand all the way north to Chiang Mai. That took maybe 20, 21 days. I went at my own leisurely pace, you know, going from monastery to monastery. So I was staying at monasteries for the most part, because you can't expect to find lodging places in remote Thailand. So I went all the way to Chiang Mai. So from the center, Bangkok is in the center of Thailand, from the very north. But I thought, okay, I want to also see the south of Thailand. But on a bicycle, it doesn't make sense to bicycle all the way. So I loaded my bicycle in a train in a foreign country. I found out that it was possible. Then I took the train all the way to the south of Thailand. So I could see Thailand in another pace, so to say, the pace of a locomotive. And then from the south, I bicycled again to Bangkok. So in my own sweet way, I bicycled from the north and south to Bangkok. So entire Bangkok, I was there for 52 days, living in monasteries, living just the way locals do, and seeing Thailand in a way that I never imagined I would. From there, my plan was to come via Myanmar to India. But that was the time when the Rohingya crisis was at peak, so I couldn't really take that. So I flew to Kolkata, and this was in the month of May 2018. The monsoon was approaching, and I wanted to go to Bhutan and the northeast, but it was not feasible. So I googled, okay, where can I go where the monsoon would not bother me? The answer was Ladakh. Okay, fate has that plan for me. So I took a train from Kolkata to New Delhi. From New Delhi, I started bicycling towards Ladakh. And I used to stay in monasteries in Thailand. In North India, that became Gurdwaras. So I would go from one Gurdwara to the other. And since I had stayed in a community, the feeling of staying with a community again, of a different sort, of course, but with the same underpinnings of, you know, brotherhood, that really had a deep effect on me. You know, like, here I am at the mercy of whoever I meet, but I always meet friendly people. And once the Gurdwara trail was over, then I started to stay with the army, because in Ladakh, that's all you find. And like this, I bicycled to the highest road in the world, at that moment at least, Khardungla, which I had not imagined I would do. You know, a rookie bicyclist, no training of riding in the hills, no training of riding with a geared mountain bike. But on the 75th day since I have started riding, I was at the top of the world, metaphorically. So sometimes not going with a plan takes you to these places, right? Which you don't imagine that you would reach. And then eventually I came back to Delhi. I went to Nepal, Bhutan, and there was a half marathon happening in Pune that my fellow friends were going to run in. So I took a train to Pune. I ran a half marathon. I was supremely fit because I was bicycling 8 hours a day, every day in and day out. And then from Pune, I bicycled all the way in the Konkan coast till my hometown in Kerala, the town called Thrissur, and that's where I concluded my journey. So yes, I don't know how many kilometers, how many detours, how many dead ends, how many places where the road ends and the sea begins. But yes, all of it was worth.
But out of curiosity, as a young man who's an engineer who was dabbling into something very interesting, how were your parents looking at this?
So this is a very interesting question, Mr. And every parent has that apprehension, you know, where is this person going? You know, like, they have always let me follow the path that I wanted to. So after engineering, I studied music for a couple of years, and they were supportive of it, and I could make a career out of it. But this was something totally different, right? But what helped me take them with me in the stride was the process of daily writing and journaling. So the moment I started my journey, I started writing about it and publishing it on my website. And I didn't know at that point, but this was kind of a sales pitch. You know, see what incredible experiences I'm going through, and I'm learning so much. And they understood it, that he's seeing things that we were not able to see, and perhaps he will not be able to see if he doesn't take these steps, and he's growing in the process. And my parents always encouraged me to write, and that was flowering a bit more, the process of writing, because there was so much novel stimulus every day, because you're in this unknown territory, and everything you see the world like a child, because everything is new, everything is fresh, the pace is new. So my parents could see the growth in me as I was traveling. So anyone who's going to embark on a similar journey, or any journey that's a bit different from the usual, it's very important to share what we are undergoing, because we are doing it from a place of excitement. And once we successfully share that excitement in whatever medium, it helps other people, not just parents, but other people, our loved ones, our friends who are concerned about us, also excited and kind of looking forward. Okay, you did not post tomorrow. What happened? Tell us. Then they become co-travelers, right?
Okay.
There were points in the journey where I was lost for 7 days or so. The moment I passed Rohtang Pass, there is no real internet connection. And I wanted to post my blog. I used to blog every day. But those 7 days, it was not possible. So I was kind of off the radar. And when I finally called my mother from an army post in Jammu, I could really hear the relief in her voice. I also wanted to contact them, but there was no way to do it. But that was the point when I realized that these people are traveling with me. And it also instilled a seed in me that it's my responsibility to bring these stories back to people. And so that's how, fortunately, I was writing all these things on my blog, which eventually I managed to put together in a string of stories and the book that you have.
So, you make a very important statement, like, to bring out the child in you. And as your book starts, you actually talk about a very interesting man that you meet on the first day, and that is the coconut seller, and where you actually spend your night and have dosa and everything. What was that feeling on the first day of your journey, like when you were really trying to relive some of your childhood moments?
So this coconut seller, his name is Saviraj. And incidentally, I used to go to, my music school was quite close to this person's coconut shack. And my music teacher and I used to go here often. This is on the East Coast Road between Chennai and Pondicherry. So when I started from Pondicherry, I thought, okay, let me try to find this person. And this was a coconut shack, and we used to always go in a car or on a bus, or in some form of motorized transport. So we just thought about where we started and where we ended, and we never paid attention to what was around. But this time I was on a bicycle. So how to find this person? I did not pay attention to what was around this person's house. But at one moment, I reached near the area where he used to keep his coconut shack. And I just knew that he was around. You know, it's just this instinctive feeling that our mind stores, but we don't really consciously know. But subconsciously we do. And I realized that this person is somewhere around. And I had to ask around a little bit, but I finally found this person. And this was the first day of my bicycle trip.
Yes.
So to get this instinctive feeling that you are close by to a friend, to an acquaintance, I won't even call him a friend, an acquaintance. And then just to go them and actually find them there. And them not only welcoming you, but offering you a place to sleep. Yeah, like did not have to worry about anything. It's how, you know, when a footballer scores a goal and then he goes back to his dugout and everyone is taking care of them. You know, he's sitting like this and people are putting ice packs and things like that. It was a similar feeling. To get this feeling on the first day, I did not speak Tamil. So, you know, there was quite a lot of sign language involved in conveying what I was doing. And it's not usual to see a decked up bicyclist heading towards Chennai. But to find someone so welcoming, so friendly, on the very first day, it was a very important sign for me. I just used my imagination to tell me that, okay, you are not going into stranger's land. You are only traveling to another friend. He is a friend to be and not a stranger. And the moment I made that switch in my mind, I always met a friend every day waiting for me at the end of the day who was ready to host. Because in this form of travel, you never know where you're going. You never know where you're going. Your bed is going to be, what your ceiling is going to be. Sometimes it's the stars. Sometimes it's a tent. Sometimes it's just a beautiful house that allowed you to stay. So, but to have this openness of believing that, you know, there are friends all around, you just have to go them with the openness so that they accept you wholeheartedly. To feel this the very first day helped me to retain that childlike self. Okay, when I was a child, my mother used to say me that even if it was a 60-year-old, you would always say, oh, I'm going to meet a friend. And here I was meeting Saviraj, who was also kind of 60. And I said, oh, he's a friend. And so many strangers, I met people, even elder, even younger, who helped me in miraculous ways, in their own sweet ways. So, this feeling of brotherhood and camaraderie has stayed with me because of that first interaction. And I was not merely convincing myself that this was the case. This ended up being the case. There are friends waiting for us everywhere if we go with openness in our country.
So, you know, like what you say is about that brotherhood, friends are waiting and things. And I see it within your book, and you give some amazing anecdotes. Like you meet a lady named Aruna on your flight. Probably that's the flight that you're taking to Thailand. And then at one end in Ladakh, you meet the armed forces person who's given you food because he knows that you have to travel 50 odd kilometers and there's nothing going to be on en route. So it was a very natural thing that people were coming together. It's all about goodness of people, as you were seeing.
Well, it the thing is, for example, I'll share an anecdote from Ladakh. So this was, I think, the second highest pass, Baralacha pass, when you go to Ladakh. And there was an army convoy that was headed towards Manali. And I was going the other way. And the person responsible to take that convoy, he saw from a distance that a bicyclist is, you know, going up this steep pass. And he stopped the convoy. And he said, "Where are you going?" And I said, "You know, this is my route. I want to go to Ladakh." So said, "Have you eaten anything?" I said, "I was hoping there would be something at the next pass," not knowing that, you know, passes at the highest point where generally you might not find much, right? And then he just called someone. They opened a stainless steel ka dabba, right? So those tiffin ka dabba. And he said, "There's aloo, there's roti. Just make a roll and eat quickly. We are getting late, but we wanted you to be fed before we did." And I thought, did they stop because they had something personal with me? And I realized, you know, it could be anyone who was going up this path and they would have stopped. So who they were really being considerate about is the person who has the willingness and the spirit to go solo on a bicycle all the way up, which they are used to going on a, you know, properly equipped truck. So sometimes people enable you to do things that sometimes they might not be able to do, but they are so happy to be even a little part of your journey, right? Many times in Thailand, I would be offered food for free, partly because I was from India and we share a common ancestry and brotherhood exists there as well. I just had to say I was from India and there, you know, India, you know, in their own field. But everyone wanted to be a part of a journey that meant something more to them as well. You know, to see someone going on a bicycle all the way the openness of wanting to see your country. Something happened at the immigration office as well in Thailand, which is not mentioned in the book. So initially my itinerary was 28 days and I had to book a return ticket to apply for a visa. And the immigration lady, and they are pretty stern people, they don't show any emotions. And she asked me, "Why do you want to come to Thailand for 28 days? Indians generally, they wrap their travel within a week and they're back." And I just sincerely said, "Ma'am, I really like your country. I want to see your country. And the only way to see it is to see it a little slowly. I quit my job. I just want to see your country." She looked at me and then she did a stamp. I didn't know what that stamp was. But when I was exiting and when I got my passport, she had given me a visa for 60 days. She could have easily given me a visa for 30 days. That would have covered my 28-day travel. But somehow she believed in me. And I was able to communicate to her beyond that immigration officer. And she let me do this. So what I say is everyone wants to enable you on a journey that perhaps they might not be able to do, but they find it worth enabling nevertheless. So even people with the littlest of resources, they do their part in helping you. It might be just with a friendly hello. When you're in the seventh hour of your bicycling ride, that hello means a lot. So people are helpful and they will always enable you to do something that they might have wanted to do. And something as challenging as this, everyone somehow nurses that feeling that, oh, it's something that I wish I did. So, you know, starting from the people in the hinterland to people in the army to the immigration office, everyone kind of connected to this story that I did not know I was living at that time. But yes, people love to help. People are incredibly kind if you are open enough to accept help.
Of course. And if I ask you, like, on this whole thing called, say, journey of life, there is so much learning that you've actually gained through this whole biking trip. How would you like to summarize in a way that this is what I'd learned, 3-4 big things as we move to the next pasture of our interaction?
Wow, to distill something so profound to three things. One of the things that I really sincerely started believing in is that karma really, really, really works in its miraculous ways. And the real playground where you see it come back like a boomerang the soonest is when you are out of your comfort zone. Right? Because there have been many instances where I really, really, really needed help. And absolute strangers in the unlikeliest of circumstances have given me exactly what I need. Sometimes it would be very late at night and I would not know where I would sleep. And then I would see this shining monastery and I would just bike in and there would be people waiting for me to, okay, come. As if they knew I was coming. So, and at some point or the other, I realized I have to give this back. Like, this is just the universe telling me that if you're going with enough courage, you will be rewarded with a welcoming energy. But you should also be able to give that energy back. So even while I was traveling on a very limited budget, on a shoestring budget, I found places where I could help. And I did help. Whether it be just through volunteering or if someone needed any monetary help, I would do that. So in this way, you know, karma played in a reverse fashion. We always think that kar bhala to ho bhala. But here it was ho bhala to kar bhala. Like something good is happening to me. People are helping me. So why not help more people? And this motif has stayed constant throughout my life, even after stopping to travel. Because if for 8 months you constantly get this feedback, okay, this is the way to think, this is the way to be, then it becomes easier to apply that into your life as well. Another thing is resourcefulness. On a bicycle, when you bicycle, you must carry everything that you need. There is no porter, there is no pulley. You're ascending a mountain, and if you're carrying 1 extra liter of water, that's 1 extra kg that's pulling you back. So every time you're reminded exactly how much you need, and only carry that. If you carry anything extra, it will find a way to fall down because it's not a trolley. You're barely tying things together to make sure that they last the ride. So that's also an interesting lesson that I got, that you know what we have to know when what is enough. We have to know that and we have to respect that, and that will make the journey so much easier in bicycling and in life in general.
So you know I would like to read something out of your book, if you don't mind. Which I two or three things which I would like to dabble a little more, but I found these to be amazingly great statements. As you progress on the road, you will leave behind a lot of intangible impediments to your evolution, your fears, conditioning, apprehensions, and perceived limitations. In return, with each stroke of the pedal, you will be gifted with courage, humility, curiosity, and a gamut of fresh perspective. Can we say this is possibly the philosophy of life distilled into these four lines from your perspective?
Yes, indeed. And I think most people realize these things, but the journey is longer. Like people in the twilight of their lives, maybe they are able to say something like this, and that we agree because they've seen life. But this kind of a journey is kind of a fast forward button where you live an entire lifetime within that new reality. And then you realize, okay, what exactly do I need? Right? And am I being treated kindly? And if so, am I treating others kindly? Right? Are others enabling my dreams? And if so, am I enabling theirs? Right? And what is the, at the end, every person is equally valuable. I see them as spokes of a wheel, right? No matter how rich, no matter how poor, they all play a part in our lives. We are connected. So when I break a spoke of the wheel, I realize how difficult it is to bicycle any further. And it's the same with any life, from the person who collects trash to the person who is sitting in the bank. All these people are equally enabling our lives. Like no spoke is more important than the other, right? And on the road, you meet such people. I met a deaf and mute bicycle repairman in Thailand. And he was so amazed that I was doing this. You know, he was not able to, of course, say this in words, but his mind was blown. And such a person offered to fix my bike for free. Now he was in need, but he still helped me with the limited resources he had. So every person enables your journey in one way or the other. Maybe in my daily life, I would not have noticed such a thing. But when you are at the mercy of the forces of nature, and you see such things, you kind of attribute more like the value that each person deserves. I should not say more, but each person deserves equal value in our life. And a journey like this kind of fast forwards all of that and helps you think, see things a little clearly.
And you also make a very interesting statement, which I jotted down, which is like, life has gifted us a yarn of time. And at each moment we are alive, we are weaving our story in the tapestry of existence. So what was going through your mind when you were writing this?
This is in just a moment. Let me pull out that story. This is the story with the bag, I remember.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this how everyone is equally rich. That's the story, if I'm not wrong.
Yeah,
let me just pull it out. I was in this story, I speak about how every life is equally valuable. Depends on where you attribute this value from. Every person on this planet is somebody's child, right? And do they not value the world to their parent? Then how do we say someone's life is more important than the others? Right? That's where the thought began. And in that, the first time a child speaks or a child stands up, you know, they take their hands off the wall and they're finally able to stand on their feet. That moment brings equal joy to each parent, right? And this will bring the same joy to that kid when they become a parent. So there are certain things that life offers a democracy over happiness to everyone, right? When we see what's inherently there in our lives, life becomes richer. But if you start comparing, you know, it's never enough. So what I thought is that, you know, each moment we are living one form of story or the other, and we are welcome to have this worldview. The poorest of the poor person and the richest of the richest person is living a story. And the simpler our longings are, the more grounded we are to our existence, you know, the more simpler and more without, there would be no effort in living, because life itself gives you that inherent richness that makes you happy to be alive, right? It's not every big achiever is as happy as the mother who lays their child to sleep, right?
Mm-hmm.
We are, you know, slowly coming to times where women are getting equal rights as men, but I feel that a man, sadly, because of evolution or nature, doesn't have equal rights, because a mother can bring a child to this earth. They can lay a baby to sleep. They can nurse them. They can feed them. We can never feel these things as men, right? So sometimes when women are going through a tough time, you know, just realizing that they have this power to bring a life on earth, that can bring them some happiness. And that happiness is unparalleled.
So, beautiful.
They're all living these stories. It's just about how we see them and how we simplify them to make our lives a little easier.
And you ask a question in your book, who am I? Were you able to grapple with the question and find an answer for yourself at large?
I love nature a lot, and I try to learn from it in every chance that I get. And I see this question as a seed asking itself, who am I? When it's asking, it's already becoming a sapling. And then it's asked again, who am I? And soon it's a plant. And then it asks again, the inquiry, it's never ending. In our lives, we always keep asking ourselves, who am I? And then we have some branches. And then we ask again, and then we are a tree. And then we have flowers, and then we have fruits, and then we are a seed again.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But from that singular seed, there are millions of seeds that have born, that have been born. So it's an evolving cycle, and the inquiry just helps us grow more and more and more.
Yeah. You know? So I'll stay with the book for a little more time. And, you know, like in one of your stories that I was going through, if I were you, and I'm just making a very brash statement, and you can dislike, you did not take insurance. From my point of view, it was probably the most idiotic, obnoxious decision that a person takes. Mm-hmm. Insurance is so bloody mandatory. And then you simply said, I'm not going to do it. And you've tried to rationalize in your book by saying, oh, like the 10% money I probably donated and all those kind of things. In hindsight, well, how do you really look at this decision now? Like once your journey is over and things.
Things could have gone wrong. Things did go wrong. But it helped me to find solutions within. A medical emergency is something that I was fortunate that I did not have to face. I would agree to that. But to tell you the truth, once I started traveling, I did not have the mind space to entertain the inquiry of whether I'm safe or not. Right? The thought of getting an insurance comes when you entertain that little insecurity that what if something. Mm-hmm. But when I was traveling, I was meeting family every other day. I was so secure in my entire being that I could never entertain that question that do I even need it? Right? I mentioned in the book that it only occurred to me again when I was at a hostel and when I heard people talking about it, and I looked, oh, my journey is really risk prone. It is. So what if something happens? But the next day I start bicycling again, I meet friendly people again, and the thought. So in hindsight, you can say, okay, I could have taken an insurance. But while you are en route and you don't have the mind space to entertain these inquiries, then it just becomes easier to travel, at least at that point. And if you say in hindsight, did I really need it? Well, I'm here and I'm safe and I'm grateful for that. And I'm happy that I could contribute something to other people who needed it at that moment more than I did. And anyway, as I mentioned, I did not have the budget to, secure myself for an unlikely event. So yes, that's the way it went. And I'm happy in hindsight that it was the way it was.
But you say something very important for the way the economy runs at large in your book. Hmm. And what you term as kindness economy. And I think I get fascinated by that whole idea. And I did get fascinated with that idea. Like the idea of giving and finding happiness and possibly looking at the thing that other people continue to really foster that spirit. Hmm. So I think in your ways, or what you're really trying to say is that we can solve the world in many, many ways if we really follow that whole aspect of kindness and giving back. What do you think? Like, how do you really think that the world can follow this principle across the board?
Okay. So, there's this thing that nothing can be extrapolated to the whole world. But let's just expand it to a little bit. Let's say, think of a community. Okay. I wrote a short story recently. I'd just like to quote it a little bit. So, mm-hmm. It was Corona pandemic time. Okay. And, there's this village called Noonpur. And in Noonpur, everyone is really grappling with food shortages. It's really getting difficult and everyone is locked inside. Nobody is allowed to go outside. So how do we secure our ration? And then one day someone really gets agitated in this village and he decides, okay, I'm going to loot the ration shop. And then following his lead, other people come, more people come, and the entire village is looting this ration shop. And since it's looting, it's not organized. So everyone picks up a sack and runs. You know, they get what they can and they reach home. Okay. Now this poor guy who runs the public distribution system shop, he goes to the sarpanch, says, my whole shop has been looted. Just a few bags remain here and there. And everyone has left with everything. I don't know what to do. And the sarpanch is responsible to make sure that everyone gets food, right? So, and this comes in the paper next day. Like, you know, there was a looting in the public distribution shop. Now, what would happen now? So now this sarpanch goes to the public distribution shop. He checks, okay, what is left? So he sees two sacks that are still left. And then he checks what's there inside that. And then he's really disappointed. Why did these people leave this pack? So now what he does is he collects all the newspapers of the present day, and he wraps a little bit of whatever is left in these two sacks, and he goes to every door, knocks, but nobody opens because he's the sarpanch, right? He has this big pagdi and everyone is scared that, you know, he's coming to ask, why did you loot the ration shop? He knocks, nobody opens. He just leaves this little bag outside the house, leaves. And he does this for all the houses in the village. And late at night, when people open their door and take this packet, they find something that none of them thought that they should loot. And it was salt. So all of them made their own dishes at their homes with whatever they could loot, but they did not have salt. And the serpents knew that what are these going people going to do without the salt? So whatever you cook today, let there be salt in your food. And there was enough salt in their porridge, in everyone's meal, but there was also a little bit more salt because they wept. Because the paper in which he had enclosed the salt had the news of everyone stealing the ration. So what I tried to say through the story is that within that community, there was enough for everyone. But it's because of this panic that everyone got what they needed, but it was somehow not holistic, wholesome. And with the right kind of jugaad leadership, if you would like to say, they all ate a meal with the realization that, you know, we all had enough if we shared in the way that we should have.
Sure. So just moving ahead on this, you know, like just moving beyond the book.
Yes.
You have said you also have some ideas around designing your own education and things like what do you think about it? Like, because if you say designing your own education, what would mean is that are we really trying to say let the universities go, or what is your larger set of thinking of this?
No, certainly not. Universities give a great framework for us to learn, to connect, and to learn from brighter minds of our times. Having said that, that should not be considered as the only way you can get an education. Every child is different, and whatever excites them, there is an expert in every field. And if a child is really fascinated about something, with the degree of connectedness we have right now in the world, we can rush to an email, I want to learn from you. And more often than not, they will write back. What I mean to say is that we can customize our education a little bit. I read a lot of things that I don't even remember, but they did take up a huge chunk of my time because I had to go through that process to be called an engineer. And engineering is a beautiful field. But not everything was applicable to my growth. So, for example, I really am interested in community living and reforestation. So I thought, okay, let me give myself the space to go and volunteer at a place. This is at the prime of my youth, and I'm volunteering. But I have the firm conviction that there is something to learn from this experience. And I have to say, this is the most immersive form of study that I have been. Right? Living in a forest. Just think about that. In a hut where you know that snakes are around, but you let them be because you know you are in their habitat and not the other way around. Or working in a dynamic working environment where every 14 days new people come in, but you are, you know, sharing an ideology and hence things work. So you're thinking about larger things, about why the ideology matters more than the constancy of people you're working with. Or if you're really living in a closed system as a forest, you can't really afford to throw things away because there is no away. It's all a closed-knit community. If you throw a mosquito net away, the vines will take over in monsoon. You know that, but you don't want that. You want the forest to be as pristine as possible. But you won't be able to notice these things in a normal setting. It's difficult. But there are places that offer you to volunteer at these places. If engineering interests you, genuinely interests you, you can tinker around at a workshop. If traveling interests you, go and travel, but make sure you bring something back for the community to share that what you learn. Right? These are all options that are open and they're not expensive. For example, I went for 2 years of volunteering. It didn't cost me anything. Of course, it cost me my time, but you know, the returns are, I mean, I can't even compare how much I learned from an experience like this.
So, Srinath, you know, sorry, go ahead, please. You were saying something.
And similarly with travel, I travel on a very shoestring budget. The idea of travel is how it's portrayed is like you need to have money and you need to have 4 or 5 days free to travel like a king. But you can travel like a, you know, like a pauper, like a Sufi, you know, just travel with the limited means, and the world is still the same. A landscape, a beautiful panorama is still the same, right? It's not different for two people. So I'm just saying that I did not have the means to necessarily go to big universities, but I designed my own education within my limited means, and they have really helped a great deal in forming my worldview and my opinions. And I'm happy that I took that step, and that's why I endorse it.
Very nice. But Srinath, you know, like you have your contemporaries who were part of your engineering school. And I think 99% of them would be somebody like who are seeking jobs and everything and going beyond the idea of learning and things like that. They just want a fixed sum of money to come in, or it's not about learning. Mm. And here you are talking about learning and everything. How do they look at you? If I know it is not important, but at the end of the day, how do they look at you, and how do you really look at that perspective itself of job seeking rather than learning and growing as a person?
Great question. Since you deal with universities so much, so I'm not surprised that this question comes up. they're curious as to what's up with this guy. Because I was fairly good at academics, and everyone thought that I would go in that academic line, and you know, I thought I had the wherewithal to do well in that system. But my hunger for learning was beyond this system also at some point, and that's why I took this detour, so to say. Let me tell you with complete honesty that people who go abroad to study, for example, when they are earning in a different economy, and of course they are doing materially better than you are. But what adds more value to how I'm living is that I'm able to bring stories to these people. I'm able to bring experience to these people. I'm able to bring a book to these people, which are stories that might not exist if I don't take that step out of the desire to learn. So I managed to bring some form of perspective in my own way to the world, hoping that, always believing that there is something to learn for other people also from my journey. And likewise, I would like to learn something from their journey as well. These are not really tangible assets that you can touch. Of course, a book is an asset, but otherwise the stories that you bring are not tangible assets. But what helps you be at peace is that these perspectives and stories stay with you in the way you live. They are not just stories that you write and publish and yada, yada, yada. It's not about that. It's about living these stories and really believing in your own story. That can only come if you have taken your own, you have tread your own path, you've taken your own journey. So yes, they coming back to your question, they look at my journey as in a curious frame of mind, but they're happy that I bring something to the table that, you know, poor people working in the same work environment might not be able to. So that kind of becomes my larger role in this kind of setting.
Sure. And just moving ahead on this, and these are uncertain times, and COVID has really dismantled the way we were all living and going through our daily chores and everything. But how do you think your experience of travel has helped really dealing with the pandemic, and what is it that you can actually tell people how to deal with it, or how to deal with the vagaries of life?
Just borrowing something from the travel, each day I would start at the crack of dawn, like right in the morning, but I was so excited to start, and this excitement came knowing that I will not know where I'm going to sleep tonight, right? That's one question that we never have to address. All all of us who are privileged enough, we always know there's going to be a roof on our head, and we never ask, where am I going to sleep tonight? But when you're traveling, that, especially on a bicycle, this question is a recurring theme. But every day of my trip, I found a nice place to stay at. I found the hospitality that I needed. And even if it was a little bit difficult, the next day was a little better, right? So you kind of start to think of days as years. If a certain day is not good, maybe the next day would be. Similarly, this year is not good, the next day would be. As I said, it kind of gives you a shorter lifetime within that period that you travel in this manner. So you kind of are more accepting to even the vagaries of life, and you move ahead with, you always move ahead, right? You're never stationary on a bicycle. You move ahead with the belief that things will get better. I have to keep moving on. Secondly, you have to be extremely resourceful when you're on a bicycle, as I mentioned earlier, right? So of course, in the pandemic, we had limited resources, but we had to find a way to feed ourselves, especially in the first few months of the pandemic. So I'll share some things that happened at my very home. So we were running out of fresh things to cook. We had our lentils and stuff. We did not have any fresh stuff. And then my mother told me there is a moringa tree outside. And it's the month of March and April. And, you know, it's starting to flower. It means there will be drumsticks or seed pods soon that we can. So we let the tree blossom. We just harvested a few flowers and ate them and left the flowers that needed to be to make these drumsticks. And the next month we ate these drumsticks. And when finally the monsoon was going to arrive, and we knew that it's going to shed its leaves to get new leaves, we harvested the leaves. We consumed that. Many people in our neighborhood did not know of this. But they started observing us and saw that there is so much bountiful harvest already in front of us. We never saw it as a resource. Then we started cooking aloe vera with many people in Rajasthan cook. And my mother had been in Rajasthan during her work, and she knew that you could cook this. And then everyone realized everyone has an aloe vera tree in their home. So everyone started cooking that. So it's about resourcefulness. It's not about really being miserly, but also thinking creatively. Okay, what do we have, and how can we use this resource more creatively? And the chronology is important. If we consume all the flowers, there will be no fruits. If you consume all the fruits, the leaves would fall down. So the chronology and the knowledge was important to let the flowers grow so that we have the pods, and then finally eat the leaves. So it's just about, you know, you have to be resourceful and you have to be more open to your surroundings. There is a shopping cart right outside also, and sometimes you don't even have to pay in situations like this. So it invites you to be creative about it. You know, resourcefulness does not always mean you have to be miserly. You have to be creative, more resourceful, and see how things work. And finally, the pandemic has taught us to share, both in terms of resources and also in terms of emotion. Locked up inside a home, no matter how much access you have to Netflix and whatever tools there are, you eventually need some human to talk to, share your feeling. And this is one of the positive aspects of the pandemic, that we are finally realizing that this human connectedness is so precious. And similarly, if we have to offer ourselves to accept help, and in the same way to give help, it's a two-way street. It's the same key. When I said that when good things happen to you, you must, you know, make sure good things happen to others through you. It's the same about physical resources and also the emotional resources that you have. So, yes, at least during the pandemic, I feel that these things have really come to the fore of being resourceful, of being open to sharing things, and just helping everyone that is around us. I have this metaphor that I'd like to share, that sometimes we are shy to ask for help, right? It happens with most of us that, you know, we somehow feel that, you know, we feel beneath in some manner. But asking for help is the best thing you can do, because it offers the other person to exercise their kindness. right? When we are in our own world, we are riding on a parachute and everything is nice and good. But when you finally give off your guard and you land on the ground, that's when you realize, okay, this is my actual home. That's what happens when you ask for help. Because you realize, I feel the same hunger as this person. So why not share a meal? Something happened recently. I'll quickly just take 1 minute. So I recently shifted to Goa and we faced a cyclone last month. And we had a 36-hour power cut. And I only had a induction stove to cook food. And without electricity, I couldn't. I had all the lentils, all the vegetable stuff, but I don't have any fire, so how to cook? So late at night, pitch darkness, there's only a little light in the watchman's cabin. So I take my cooker, I put everything that needs to be put to make a khichdi. I take my mobile phone, I go to my watchman, I just say, Hidilal ji, bhook lagi. So I've come from the parachute on the ground and I've said, I'm in need of help. And he said, chalo, mere paas to hai, gas hai. We put that on the chula. And in half an hour, we spoke a lot, became friends, we shared a meal. That was the most beautiful thing that I experienced in Goa. It's not the beach. It's meeting this person who was willing to help. So in the social hierarchy, I am from a different place, he's from a different place. But it's the same ground reality where we emerged from.
Yeah, it's all about the equalizing that you're really talking about.
Yeah, yeah. And be open to ask for help. Because people want to help. Who doesn't want to be helped?
And as we move towards the closing of the interaction, we're just getting very close to time. I have to ask you 2 more questions. Like, one is, of course, being a music teacher, you make a very important point on the idea of rhythm. The emotional elements of rhythm and how rhythm probably affects your emotions. Mm. So was there any interconnectedness between your idea of music and the idea of travel as you were going through this?
Mm. So I'll tell you something interesting. Many of my musician friends, they ask me, you're not going to play your instrument for 7, 8, 9 months. Are you not afraid that you lose your touch on the instrument? And I made it a point that I did not really need to listen to music because there was so much else happening. Music is some stimulus we put in when we have that space to put in that stimulus. But there was so much else happening on my trip that I never thought, okay, let me plug in my earphones and listen to a song. Now, once I'm back from this trip, I get a show. It's a jazz fusion show, tabla and sarod and a Western instrument on where I play the drum. And they're thinking, will you be able to play? Because you have not been in touch. I said, don't worry. And to be really honest, that was the best show I played of all the shows I played. You know why? Because I learned to listen better.
Uh-huh.
In this period when there was no music, I would think I would be more sensitive to other forms of sounds that are also music in the soundscape of life. Right? Now, when you're back on stage, your ears become that much more sensitive. And since I come from a jazz background, there's always this aspect of improvisation and call and response. Now, you can only respond better if you hear better. And that had improved significantly. I did not know it myself. But then I realized, okay, a motif of silence is necessary for you to be able to express yourself with sound. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, please, please.
Go ahead, please.
No, I'm saying, in speech, the silence matters just as the words. A period matters, an exclamation matters just as much as the words. It's the same idea.
Nice. And when are you running to Bhutan? That's my next question.
So this is the next thing I want to do. I really want to see my country up and close, and I want to do it even slower. So I want to either walk or run sometime next year. And again, to reveal my motivation to you even before I begin, it's again the spirit of learning, of course, and to embrace my roots, where I come from. Because there are many people who have been inspired by, who have traveled all across India on foot, it Adi Shankaracharya or Guru Govind or Mahatma Gandhi, or travelers from abroad like Ibn Battuta. So these people, and I like how they write, and their writing has come from the things that they have experienced and seen firsthand. So one, the desire to learn; two, the desire to write better; and three, the desire to have a more comprehensive and well-formed worldview is my motivation behind the next step I'm going to do. It will happen sometime next year, depending on how COVID unfolds. But it's something that I definitely want to do.
Sure. And when you talk about your impossible list, I was just going through that list, which is fascinating. But I hope we are going to see your next book in the next 6 to 8 months' time, because you promised yourself that you're going to write a book a year.
So I am in the process of writing a collection of short stories. It's almost halfway done. And yes, I'm actively working on it. And it's going to be out next year. So I'm on it.
Absolutely. No, you know, like, this has just been a fascinating interaction, but I think I see shades of a very dear friend of mine in you. And his name is Anil Gupta. I do not know if you heard of him or not. Anil used to be a professor at IIM Ahmedabad. He's done this very interesting show, what I call walking trips across the country and things with his students. Oh. I think I see those shades. I need to put you in touch with Anil.
Sir,
so we see how both of you can connect.
So yeah. I randomly got a webinar invite for something done by Service Space in US, and Anil Gupta sir were hosting that chat, and I saw this just 2 weeks ago, and I was like, I have to get in touch with this person because he's such an enigmatic guy. You know, even if you don't know the stories behind him, the way he speaks, the wonder he exudes, and I'm like, I have to get in touch with this person, and here you are telling me that you must.
Perfect. So if I am the conduit, would be a pleasure. But Srinath, I must tell you, like, this has just been one of the finest interactions I've actually had. It's such a great learning experience. And now I understand as to why my son Dhruv is actually so enamored by you, and why is he so proud of you. And I think what you are doing is very courageous. It takes a lot of effort to doing what you're doing, to really shed your being in many, many ways, and to really go on to that journey. And I wish you luck, and I hope you are able to continue on this journey and continue to feed our thinking and people around us and with your stories and with your ideas. And I think that should happen. And God bless. Thanks a lot for joining. And it has just been such a pleasure and an honor. Thank you. Thank you, Srinath. And we'll be in touch.
Bye-bye. Bye.